Welcome to the Oddsbreakers, the number one place for shared, sharp betting information.
Welcome back to podcast 53 of 2024. I'm your host, Kiev O'Neill. You can follow me on Twitter at OBKiev. Follow us at the Oddsbreakers. Follow us on social media / the Oddsbreakers. This episode is being brought to you by this season for the largest football contest in all of the world. Please visit the SZN.com/OB. Get $10 off your bundled football package. Only $50 to get in like 10 contests. If you'd like to support the Oddsbreakers and benefit from our premium plays, please visit the Oddsbreakers.com. Click shop, become a member. Pick any for winning cappers. You get the premium plays before the line moves. You can also support us on Patreon.com. If nothing else, please visit the Oddsbreakers. Become a free picks and Telegram subscriber. We have a great show for you today. Keep trucking, baby. College football day, and we're going to talk to Kelley Ford from KFord Rankings. Kelley is a fantastic college football analyst, fan, specialist. He's got like six TVs in his little man cave there that he watches games at. He also works in college football, and he can tell us a little bit about that. But man, his stuff is good. I love how it's so easy to read. He uses big logos, names, colors, big print, big text for us aging professionals to read. So it's just put together very well. It's got a great power rating. He does everything from an efficiency type formula. He uses strength of schedule. He's got actual projections of these teams and how they're supposed to finish. He's got most deserving rankings based on schedule strength. He's got what if rankings if you flip the one score games. Watchability ranking, it's just really cool. And he doesn't even sports bet because he's not allowed to, but his numbers can be used for sports betting. So it's going to be great to talk to Kelley again. He was on last year and I believe the year before. We'll see what he's been up to shortly here. But before Kelley comes on, NFL preseason football starts today, baby. And the Bears are playing the Texans at the Hall of Fame game. And I'll tell you this, I'm not betting it. I could have bet it. It started out with a line that I knew was going to go down. I knew that the total of this game was going to go down. It's opened at 33 on DraftKings. It was at 32 in some books. I knew this thing was going to crash down to 31, 31 and a half. It might even get to 30 and a half. But the truth is, you know, I'm not so excited to bet under 33 unless I was playing somebody. You know, I mean, it's just such a low score that, you know, in football, anything can really happen. You could be on the right side of that until some crazy kickoff return happens because of the rules. You know, we still are new to some of that. You're going to have some backup quarterbacks vying for a backup position. It's even a little bit low for a trend that's been going under over the past few years in this Hall of Fame game. So, to be honest, I knew it was going down. It's at 31 and a half on DraftKings. I didn't want anything to do with it. The Bears flipped. They were favorites. And then when they announced that it's not going to be Caleb Williams starting, it's going to be Tyson Bagent. You might even see a little Brett Rippon or Austin Reed out there. It's now the Texans, but the truth is that I still wouldn't make the Texans favorite. I'd make it a pick 'em. I highly doubt you see much CJ Stroud, if at all, probably not at all. I didn't even look at that part yet. I'm just one of those situations where if you're going to get plus money on either side of this game to win, maybe that's the better bet. But the truth is that Davis Mills as backup to CJ Stroud, I mean, he's better right now than Tyson Bagent. So, Case Keenum, he's better than what the Bears have as a backup. So now you got better backups playing for the Texans. And that's really part of the handicap that matters to me. Our preseason coach motivational rankings are out, but Matt Eberflus is 4-2, still a small sample size. And then you have, for the Texans, D'Amico Ryan's only 1 year behind him at 2-1. There's just not enough information to go by to make a play. I'll probably watch the first quarter, maybe a little bit more. My son's got football practice afterwards, so I'll be caring more about that afterwards. But either way, just wanted to talk a little bit about this game. And probably a bit better if you're a football fan to watch some of the guys going into the Hall of Fame. But anyways, we have a lot to talk about because we're covering the ACC and a little bit of Group of Five with our wonderful guest, Mr. Kelley Ford. So without further ado, let's bring Kelley on the show. Now, I'm very excited to welcome back to our show Mr. Kelley Ford from KFordRatings.com. You can follow Kelley on Twitter at KFordRatings. Kelley, August, baby, we're just talking about it. It's the month for college football. How you doing?
I am doing well, Kim. It's good to be back. We are back as a college football fan base. It's exciting. It's that time of year. Every single team, especially now with the expanded playoff, can have all the aspirations in the world this time of year. It's all to be earned in front of every single team. So it's really, really fun and exciting. I can't wait for it to start.
Oh, absolutely, dude. I'm so stoked. And, you know, it, just around the corner, a couple weeks, 3 weeks, week zero, a couple games, and we're focusing on the ACC a little bit, so maybe we'll bring that up if we have time at the end here. But, you know, I'm curious about KFord Ratings. It's a great site. I look at it every year, and now you have this massive change with the playoffs and things like that, so you got to start thinking about that stuff. I guess probably to anybody new listening to this show or watching it, could you just quickly explain what KFord Ratings is and how it might have changed this year?
Yeah, for sure. So KFord Ratings is a predictive power rating set similar to, you know, Bill Connolly's SP Plus, Brian Fromo, FEI. Those are the two godfathers of college football predictive analytics, in my opinion. They have the gold standard, but I'm attempting to do the same thing that those guys are doing with your power rating. It's trying to project forward which team would be favored against which team on a neutral field if they played tomorrow and by how many points. So that is the nuts and bolts of it. All of the content that I generate at kfordratings.com stems from using the power ratings as the engine. So I have a lot of different applications. I put out a lot of different graphics and charts, but all of it stems from the power ratings. So what goes into those power ratings in the preseason, we've got three main components. It's your returning production. How much are you bringing back from last year's team? What are you adding via the transfer portal? What are you losing via the transfer portal or via graduation, via the draft, all of those things? And then how well has your team performed in my model in recent years? So what's your KFord rating been last year, 2 years ago, 3 years ago? How well have you recruited recently as a program, you know, in the last 2, 3, 4 years? Kev, the biggest thing that's changed for me from a model standpoint for this year is, and it has nothing to do with the expanded playoff, but the way that you build a roster, the way you construct a roster in 2024 is very different than it was 2 years ago, 5 years ago, certainly 10 years ago, right? With the increased usage of the transfer portal, the free transfer that everybody now has, the COVID year is still in there. So what I have done in the preseason here is I have tweaked the weighting assigned to what those three inputs are, how much goes into those three inputs, but the three inputs themselves remain the same. Once we get into the regular season, then I phase out the preseason data and I replace it with the in-season data. And then what's changed from a content standpoint this year? I've done more CFP stuff because not even that I'm more excited about the 12 team than the four personally, but the college football loving public is. And so anytime I posted anything college football playoff related, it seems to generate a lot of traction. So I've spent some more time creating some content, graphs and things like that around the college football playoff this summer. And it seems to be what people are looking for. So that's really what I'm here for, is to give the people what they want. And again, it all stems from the power ratings.
Oh, absolutely. And you're right. The last few years, a huge evolving ecosystem here with the transfers. And I think everybody's just trying to catch up to that. And, you know, stuff to be, we have to be willing to change in our outlooks, you know, but getting ahead of it as from a sports betting perspective, I know you're not in that business, but you're in the business of predicting, I think is very important because, you know, we want to be accurate, you know, we want to do things correctly. So that's huge. But, you know, I love how you have the watchability rankings. You know, that's such a fun thing to do because there's some really cool games. I think you have Texas versus Georgia and Georgia versus Bama is in Ohio State. Of course, Oregon is the top three, right?
Yeah, and so the watchability, when I posted that, that generated a lot of buzz too, which again, I really like, but there was some confusion about what the watchability is. So since you had that up there, let me just explain quickly. It has nothing to do with TV ratings or projected TV ratings or how many people are going to be watching these games, what information network executives use to determine which games go in which slots on which networks. It has nothing to do with any of that. The watchability scores are something I've done for the last 3 years now, and it's only two inputs. It's what is the projected quality of that game? So it's a weighted average of projected quality and projected competitiveness. Projected quality is what's the KFord rating of the two teams involved? Take a simple average. And then projected competitiveness, What's the projected spread of that game using my numbers? And then again, we weight those. Those are not 50-50 components. They're weighted more towards quality than competitiveness, but you mash those together. Every single game involving an FBS team can then be assigned a score from 0 to 10, and that's what I call the watchability score. So a game that was notably absent from my top 40 was Ohio State-Michigan. The reason for that, two really good teams. Ohio State's number two in my power ratings. Michigan, we're going to get to them in a second. But the projected spread in that game right now, by my model, is double digits. And so you're taking a hit in the projected competitiveness standpoint. Right. That's why that game falls outside the top 40 for me. That's still going to be one of, if not the most watched regular season game here in 2024. Both fan bases are going to be into it. The college football playoff picture is probably going to be shaped by that. Who knows? The spot in Indianapolis and the Big Ten championship might be impacted by that. But when you're looking at the two inputs that I'm looking at for watchability, that game did not score in the top 40 for that reason.
That makes total sense to me. You know, Michigan, yeah, you got to be competitive to have watchability. And I knew what your ratings were. And I'm used to this stuff because I see the Ken Poms do it. You know, the Bart Torvicks do it. The Haslametrics do it all in basketball. They show you which games should have the most exciting from a power and a competitive standpoint kind of put together. And I think that's really cool that you put it together. But I just stumbled across your CFP, so I have to talk about it, man. It's cool. I mean, you have all the teams here. And you say regular season wins required to be in the CFP at large discussion. You know, it's funny how Florida, the hardest schedule in the league, the lonely team, can actually get into the discussion with 8 wins. And I do not disagree with that, to be honest with you, looking at that schedule. And then you have poor, lonely Nevada needing 13 wins, which, do they even play 13 games, Kelley?
They do. They're the only team in college football this year that takes advantage of that Hawaii rule, where if you play Hawaii, or if any of your opponents play Hawaii, I think it is, you are able to schedule a 13th game. So not even Hawaii used the Hawaii exemption, but Nevada did. That's why they end up there in the 13 rung by themselves. And Kiev, I want to say, you know, for Florida, and I know you said you don't even disagree, I think a lot of rational people do agree with this. However, that being said, the math suggests that an 8-4 Florida should be in that conversation. And they might be in the conversation. I don't personally believe, based on what we've seen the committee do to date, that an 8-4 Florida team would actually get in that large spot in the playoff. I think the committee to date, again, the 4-team era, we'll see. Maybe they act differently in the 12. I hope they do. They have really punished teams for the numbers or rewarded them, depending on what it is. They've really emphasized the number in the loss column. And I don't believe that the committee would be able to put a four-loss team in the playoff, even if it was this Florida team against that schedule they played, which is incredibly difficult. So while I'm suggesting the math says an 8-4 Florida should be considered, I am not sure the committee would actually pull the trigger and put an 8-4 Florida into the playoff.
You're right, because they go but like deserving. If you lose 4 games, you deserve it. You know, it's like, what if I played Georgia 12 times? Come on, guys. Mm-hmm. You know, I totally get the math, and I side with the way this should be based upon strength schedule. I love how you have Wisconsin here at 9 wins. Hell, give me 9 wins, baby. That's my alma mater. We have a tough schedule this year, so I'm like, I'd be very happy to get 9 wins, and just to be talked about to get in the playoffs would be wonderful. And you see some other teams with these hard schedules as well under the 9 category.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's really how this breaks down, is based on your schedule difficulty. The teams with the most difficult schedules by my version 2 power ratings are going to find themselves needing the fewest number of wins to get into that conversation, because again, it's more difficult to achieve those wins. You talked about Wisconsin. It's a top 15 most difficult schedule for me. I do think 9 wins would be required to be in that at-large conversation. This has nothing to do with if you earn the right to be in there via an AQ for winning your conference. So that's outside of this scope. Wisconsin, by my numbers right now, 7% chance to get to at least 9 regular season wins. So that's kind of what my numbers think of the Badgers at this very early stage.
Yeah, absolutely. And what about Michigan? And I want to ask you about Michigan, since we're talking a little Big Ten. They are very impacted because Jim Harbaugh kind of had a mass exodus here. And I mean, as a sports bettor, I see their win total at 9, dude. I mean, I'm sorry, I bet the under in Michigan. It's so weird to see two amazing teams like Washington and Michigan just crumble at the end of the season with both coaches leaving. It's just, it's almost blows your mind that something like that can happen if you think about like professional sports or something like that. But it's just amazing just how people leave and transfer and go to the pros. And what do you think Michigan can do now with a new coach and keeping a few other coaches and very few players?
Yeah, let me respond to that win total number before I forget, because, again, I wasn't even tracking that 9 was their number. 9 is what my number suggests is the most likely record for Michigan, 9-3. However, that being said, I have just a 24% chance that Michigan wins 10 or more games. So to bet the over there, you need 10. So 24% chance there, a 31% chance to push. That's what I have as their chance to finish on exactly 9. And that would then leave 45% to finish at the under with 8 or fewer regular season wins. So that's kind of what my numbers think about the over-under right there. But for Michigan, I mean, you hit all the salient points. So much turnover, both on the coaching staff and with the roster. There's a lot of unknowns. The one thing that I think I do know about this Michigan team is this defense still should be pretty darn good. If we look at the last few years in my model, if you take out the COVID year of 2020, which was a weird year for a lot of teams, and Michigan really struggled that year for reasons on and off the field, like a lot of teams. Mm-hmm. If you go back to the CFP era, there have only been 2 years since 2014, again, minus 2020, that Michigan's defense has finished outside of the top 11 in my unit ratings on that side of the ball. So this has been a good defense, a really good defense for the last 10-plus years. Last year, they were number 1 on the defensive side of the ball. I'm projecting this year Michigan to be number 3 on that side. The difference for Michigan is on offense, where there's just a lot more question marks. And it doesn't mean that Michigan can't be good on offense. I had them number 9 at the end of the year last year on offensive side of the ball. They are now projecting number 28 for me. That combination of those two unit rankings and what everybody else is around them leads Michigan to be number 12 in my power ratings right now. Now, more good news for Michigan fans, though. You do have a very tough test against Texas in week 2. However, that being said, Michigan does not leave the Big House until week 6. Their first 5 games are all in Ann Arbor. Again, one of them is really, really tough against against Texas. You have another game at home against USC. People are going to be very excited about that. You know, USC joining the Big Ten, first trip to the Big House as a Big Ten member, all of these things. But it's not until week 6 that Michigan leaves the comforts of their own home. So they have a chance, especially on offense, to kind of get things going and get things figured out before they have to face a hostile road environment. So that's a good thing for Michigan. The bad thing is all the uncertainties. And like I said, I've got 9-3 is the most likely 24% chance to reach 10 wins. Michigan, for me, right now, projecting to be, if I look quickly, 4th in the Big Ten. My projected Big Ten standings behind Oregon, Ohio State, and Penn State. Michigan coming in with 6.4 projected Big Ten wins on average. Again, they play 9 conference games in the Big Ten.
It's very fortunate that they miss Penn State, but it's very misfortunate that they have to switch it with Oregon, which is a top 2 or 3 team in many people's power rankings. And they get Oregon at home, just like they get Texas at home. But getting the three of the 5 teams to face when you have so much changes, that's the 3 losses I see. And they have to run the table to get to that. You know, of course, if they jump Texas, yeah, it's going to be okay. My 9, I'm still not going to be as worried about it, but, you know, I'm thinking it's going to possibly push. But, yeah, there's just been a lot of change. They are number 17 in my power rating, so I downgraded them a little bit more. And what's funny is this is new, man. These transfers are the amount of them are just – it's still new. So it's just hard to figure out how much I'm downgrading these. I'm pretty high on Harbaugh, so, you know, that's where I'm kind of at with this team. But speaking of power ratings, let's talk about your top 12 teams then, man. I looked at yours, and it's nothing really surprising to me. And I know you do efficiency things like the FPIs, and obviously with Bill Conley, you know, it's the same type of thing. But I like your ratings. There's only one that I'm not 100% sure of, but why don't you go over your top 12?
Let me guess who that's going to be as I go through this. So, yeah, the top 12 in my power ratings right now, probably no surprise. I've got Georgia number 1. And what's more surprising to me than anything about Georgia being number 1, it's the margin by which I have Georgia number 1. I have Georgia number 1 by more than 4 points. 4 football points on a neutral field is the margin I have Georgia being number 1 over the field. I have Ohio State number 2. Oregon is number 3. Texas is number 4. Texas is a team that until last year, anytime the power ratings had a top 10 in the preseason, folks were, you know, questioning, getting upset. Last year, they finally broke through. They made the CFP, lost in the semifinal, of course, transitioning to the SEC. So Texas is going to have a tough year this year, but Texas does have the easiest conference slate of any SEC team within conference play by my numbers. Number 16 out of 16 in schedule difficulty in SEC only play. So Texas, yeah, they're in the SEC, but man, they got a good draw from the SEC conference office there. I have Alabama minus Nick Saban now, still sitting at number 5. Penn State's number 6. Notre Dame is number 7 for me. Oklahoma, That's the team that I think we're going to be going to with maybe the surprise from your end. But I've got Oklahoma sitting at number 8, Ole Miss is 9, Florida State 10, LSU 11, followed by Michigan at 12. And just to give, you know, some it's more important than the actual ranking is what is their rating and how much distance is in between these teams. So from Georgia at 30.9, almost 31 points, down to Michigan at 17, it's about a 2-touchdown difference there between Georgia at 1 and Michigan at 12. That's a pretty big gap. Again, Georgia's really far out in front of the field. But if you look at that Ohio State-Michigan, and again, that game's in Columbus this year, so you're already looking at, you know, potentially 9.5 points for that spread if it's on a neutral field. Apply whatever home field advantage you want for the shoe. That's how you get the double digits that I have for that game. And that's one of the reasons, or that is the reason, why that Ohio State-Michigan game didn't crack the top 40 of my watchability. But was I right, Kiev? Is it Oklahoma that's sticking out to you as the team that doesn't belong?
100%, man. You guessed it. It was Oklahoma. But you, in fairness, you only have them 0.9 points higher than the 12 team in Michigan. So, you know, it does really condense there. And this is not something I'm not used to, seeing the number one team in the 12 team being almost 2 touchdowns difference. I think my power ratings over the past 7 to 8 years have really echoed that. So that I think that's completely fair. And then some people say, then why do you have 12 teams in the playoffs? Then you can get all, you know, go down those roads and stuff, which is never fun. But you know, here they are. There's more chances now for people to win and for your schools and stuff like that. Maybe someday the recruiting spread out enough where it does condense a little bit. But either way, it is Oklahoma. I'm just not super high on Brett Venables. They lost their quarterback, obviously, to transfer here. If I'm blanking on this, I thought they lost their offensive coordinator too. I'll have to relook at that. But why don't you go ahead and tell us why you're higher in Oklahoma?
Yeah, so Oklahoma is an interesting team. And here's why I say that, because I don't personally disagree. Like, Kelley Ford, the person, doesn't think Oklahoma's number 8 in the country. But the model does, and the model is right more than it's wrong. It's proven that over the course of, you know, 5-plus years now. So I trust it as a starting point, but it's certainly one that made me dig in a little bit deeper because my personal feeling on them is not quite as high. This is a team where if you look back, let's just look at their recent history. You know, going back through the CFP era, and I know they've had a couple different head coaches during this time. A lot of things have changed with that program, with conference affiliation, just with the national landscape of college football. But let's just look at this team over the last decade or so. They have only been outside of the top 11 in my power ratings at the end of the year twice. They were number 13 in 2019 and they were number 23 in 2022. Last year, Oklahoma finished number 10. This year, I've got them projecting with a top 15 offense and a top 15 defense. However, with all of that said, one of the reasons that I feel okay about having Oklahoma where they are is I really don't think it's going to matter too much, to be completely honest. Like, once we get into the season, we're going to know what this team is, and the rating will adjust accordingly. However, this schedule is so difficult. It's number 6 most difficult in the entire country overall. It's number 3 most difficult SEC conference-only schedule. It's so difficult that even though Oklahoma's number 8 in my power ratings, I'm still projecting 8-4 for the Sooners this year. So I don't necessarily think that Oklahoma is as good as the model does. However, because the schedule is so difficult, I'm not sure that my personal viewpoint on this team's schedule or on this team's record, at the end of the year is much different than what the model is suggesting anyway. So for me, it's a really balanced team, top 15 offense and defense with a really good history here. And Brett Venables, you say you're not a huge believer in him. The defense is what's needed to be upgraded in Norman really for the last decade. He has done that. It was 63 2 years ago. It was 29 last year. I'm projecting number 15 this year. So I think if he can get that side of the ball settled, the offense, we would have to guess because of history, is always going to have a sufficient amount of talent on it to be successful. I'm very curious to see how Oklahoma and Texas perform this first year in the SEC, though.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. And I guess Luttrell was there last year as an offensive assistant, so it's kind of some continuity as it is. It's all about Jackson Arnold then, isn't it, to see how well he does. And you're right, it is a tough schedule, you know. Obviously an SEC schedule, and I'm very skeptic on some of those teams transferring conferences. I think it's going to be a little rougher in general than people think. Last question about your ratings. When is the preseason connotations get completely factored out? I know some people that do it maybe after week three or week four. Some people wait to week 6 or 7. At what point is it pure efficiency coming in from this year in the play of the game?
I have done a lot of back testing and a lot of playing around with this exact question because I think this is very important for the accuracy of any model. And so what I've done is, using historical data, come to the solution that I believe leads to the most predictive and most accurate projections. And that's surprising for some. They actually stay in the entire year. Now, by the end of the year, the weight is very, very small. I mean, it's almost negligible by the end of the year. However, I do have a weight associated with the preseason component, even at the end of the year. So that's what I have found through my own testing to be the most predictive, the most accurate. I know at one point Bill Connolly had it phased out by, I can't remember when. I think he is now in the camp of leaving it in all the way. That's certainly of note to me. I do know that KenPom, from a basketball standpoint, phases it out by about the new year, I think. Like, basically, once we get into January, I think his is about out. But the difference between basketball and football is, in a football season, a regular season, we only have 12 data points. That's a really small sample size. So especially early in the year, when you only have, let's say, 2, 3, 4 data points, like, each one of those data points is taking up a huge portion of your in-season data. So if you had an outlier performance early in the year, which we probably don't know until late in the year, that could drastically change the projection for your team, whether it's right or wrong, in the positive or negative direction, I should say. So to me, that's further validation. Our small sample size of games is validation to keep that preseason weight in there, that anchor in there. The preseason ratings could be wrong. I fully admit that. However, they're right for more teams than not. And those that are wrong are usually not wrong by too much. So that's some behind the scenes, inside baseball, if you will, with the power ratings in my model that I do. But I do keep them in there throughout the year. It's a very, very small weight by the end of the year, though.
I think that's a great, great answer. You know, here's the thing. You're right. The sample size is a lot smaller. I actually think KenPom does go into January for a little bit for conference season. I think he wants to see some conference play before he does. I know Haslametrics ends his in December because it all blends together. He says it's just a great question. But here's the thing. How many times have we said, oh, now your 5 stars decide to play football, guys? You know, it's kind of like, you know, all of a sudden, it took you all season to gel together. What were you doing in the preseason? You know, I feel like, as a fan and a sports bettor, we've said that so many times. And so you got to kind of keep that inclination that, hey, these guys are supposed to be talented. They've had talent. They just probably in the summer just blew it off a little bit too much. Maybe the coach wasn't on them enough. And, you know, that's obviously a separation with coaches. You have to understand that you rank coaches as well. I've seen that happen a million times. So that's great. I'm excited to see how it comes to the end with your power ratings as well as mine, and just see where we were right, where we were wrong. And if not adjusting it quick enough is fair, especially from a spread perspective in the middle of the season. So that's going to be fun to watch.
When do yours get phased out, Kev, if you don't mind me asking? When are you at zero for the preseason weight, or do you get to zero during the season? Or do you not share that? Because I certainly don't want you to spill secrets.
What's funny is mine actually is assigning points. My algorithm, though, however, will wipe it out after 3. I have 2 systems. My power ratings, I'm just assigning points. And if I have to downgrade something, I'm downgrading it pretty good if I get 3 or 4 games, you know? If I get 3 or 4 games and it's really not panning out, that's probably literally 4th game after that is really when I'm kind of like, you know, I was wrong about this team. The offensive line group was not as good as I thought it was. Instead of, you know, giving them a 5, I'm giving them a 2 or 1 or 0 or -1. You know, so I go from a negative to a positive. Some people just do all positive, 0 to 10. I do negative to positive. So I have like somewhat of a median. That's how I do my power ratings. But I have an efficiency algorithm that just literally takes data a little bit from last season, how it happened right in the beginning. And then it phases that out pretty quickly around week 4. So if that's fair, I have 2 2 systems I use, so hopefully
I like it. Hey, helps balance it out, and you're able to the more, and people talk about this, and this is not to get off the track on football, but we've talked a little bit about college basketball. When you look at the team sheets in college basketball, and you've got, you know, the multiple metrics on there, that's good, and you should have that, because then you can identify if there is a team or teams who are outliers in a certain metric, a certain system, and then you can kind of try to conceptualize it and figure out why is that team an outlier there. So hey, you say you have 2 models that you're using, or 2 kind of inputs. I think that's great. I think if we could aggregate, you know, the top 3 to 6 power rating models that are out there to create kind of a consensus power rating, I actually think that would probably be the most beneficial and the most accurate, because every single one's going to have blind spots and outliers. So I think it's great that you got 2, and thanks for sharing a little bit about the process there.
Oh, no problem. And I think that what you just said is genius, because they're some of the best sports bettors I know combine three or four power ratings that they really, really trust, you know?
Yep.
And I think that's just the best way to do it. You know, you seem to do it like me. You have the top team in the, around the 30-point range and the bottom team around the minus in the 20s. You know, how far can Kent State fall this year, right? You know, you never know. But so, I mean, I've had UMass down to minus 30 before. So just to let you know, I've had it pretty bad. But no, that's the fun of it. But hey, we got some football to talk about. A little bit of ACC, man. And what I like about KFord ratings too is like you actually have your conference wins projection because that's important. What if I screw up and drop to a group of five team? Well, guess what? I'm still in the hunt for the college football playoffs. I am not out of it because all I have to do is win my division if I'm a Power Five school. And I think that's a cool thing. And now you're talking about actual conference wins. That's a fun thing to talk about too. So let's start with these questions. And I'm looking at the ACC, and I'm going to start with Florida State because they're a very popular team. Just to let you know, their win total in conference is 6.5. Where do you line up with that?
I've got them with six projected conference wins, 6.5. I've got a 35% chance that they reach at least seven. So it really is kind of right there in that ballpark. For Florida State, you know, they are my favorite in the ACC. They're the highest power rated team. Their schedule is among the more difficult within conference play, which is interesting because when you're one of the best power rated teams, highest power rated teams, you typically have a weaker schedule difficulty because you can't play yourself. But Florida State being the most highly power rated team in the ACC by my model and still having the number four schedule difficulty out of 17 teams says that this is actually a pretty legit tough schedule within conference play. That being said, my numbers do favor Florida State in every single game they're playing this year within the ACC. There's only one game on the Noles schedule that they are not a projected favorite. That is a non-conference game, week 11 at Notre Dame. I've got a 33% win expectancy there. So Florida State, if you're looking at the conference games, the ones that kind of catch my eyes, you know, I'll go with three of them. Week five, they have to go to SMU. I have a 60% win expectancy there. SMU is a top 30 team for me in the power ratings, top 40 on both sides of the ball. Their first year in the ACC, their first year as a power conference team, at least since the 90s. So we will see how SMU adjusts. The very next week, Florida State welcomes Clemson to Tallahassee, 59% win expectancy there. Clemson, my number two projected team in the ACC. We'll get to them in a second, I'm sure. And then the third game to really highlight for them is a big rivalry game. It's week nine. It's at Miami, 59% win expectancy. Miami's a top 20 power rated team. And some people will laugh at that or say, yeah, but Mario Cristobal can't coach or look at his in-game decisions. And hey, I'm not going to disagree with any of that. From a talent standpoint, this Miami team is top 20. They're top 40 on both sides of the ball. And having to go to Miami, depending on how their seasons have gone to this point, that could be a very pivotal game in the ACC race there in week nine. But Florida State at number 10 in the power ratings is my favorite in the ACC. They're top 20 on both sides of the ball. And I do expect, if you're saying who's going to make it out of the ACC, if I had to pick one team, I'd pick Florida State. And you know what? As a neutral fan, I'm not a fan of Florida State. I'm not a fan of an ACC team. I think that would be kind of poetic after what happened to Florida State in 2023. So wouldn't be the worst thing in the world, in my college football opinion, if Florida State got a chance this year.
Yeah, if all these were plus 100, I'd bet Florida State to win it all myself. They are my highest power-rated ACC team themselves. But like you said, you say six wins, you know, and so you would lean to the under 6.5, and I think that's fair because your numbers, you add up the percentages, and that's what it comes up to. And I'll just quick show our viewers here. So you have your nice little listed projected ACC standings, and it's got your percentages of what is the percentage of winning eight wins? Well, that's 9%, which is the highest because Clemson's at 8% to win out in the ACC. And then 27% chance they win seven games, 33% chance they win six. And I think it's laid out very well for people to see. And that's what I love about your site. Nice and big for my tired old eyes. So it works out wonderful. No, I Florida State for sure. Now DJU, not a big DJU guy. You know, I don't know. I thought he redeemed himself a little bit when he went to Oregon State, and maybe he learned a few things, but it's still a fast paced offense. I guess Oregon State was somewhat a fast paced offense, brand new team though. I mean, this team, just like Michigan, had to bring in, transfer a lot of people. Florida State did do better in the transfer portal as a whole than a lot of other teams, and I think that's huge. But for Florida State, you know, for me, I think they make it. I would say they're number one in the ACC, but at the same time, it's going to be an interesting fight for them. Number two, Clemson. Like you said, Clemson's the next one we're picking. Clemson, believe it or not, is win total at 5.5. What do you have for Clemson?
I'm projecting 6 average wins in the ACC for Clemson this year. I have them as a number 14 power rated team. They're top 20 on both sides of the ball. And if you look at their schedule in totality, there's only 2 games that my numbers make the Tigers a projected underdog. One of those, the opening game of the year, neutral site against Georgia. If you want to call it neutral site, I believe it's in Atlanta. So ask the Clemson fans what they think about that being neutral site. But then in conference play, the only game that I have Clemson as a projected underdog is that game we just talked about, week 6 at Florida State. You know, Cade Klubnik is, I don't really get into the Heisman odds. I don't do sports betting in general. You know that my numbers are out there. People use it for that purpose. And they've done well based on what they told me, which is great. I'm excited about that. I don't really get into the Heisman stuff either, but Cade Klubnik is someone who I don't know what his Heisman's odds are right now. I'm sure they're not very short. They're probably pretty long. And if you look at this schedule, and you look at them being potentially, you know, one of the 2 favorites to win the ACC and therefore make it to Charlotte and make it to the playoff, he plays quarterback for a top 15 power rated team who's only going to be a projected underdog once or twice this year. To me, 5-star recruit, I know he hasn't lived up to that yet in Clemson. That is something that I'd be taking a look at if I was betting the Heisman just as a flyer potentially, because it'll only take 1 or 2 things to go right for Clemson this year to have a really, really good season. Now, at the same time, there's only 1 or 2 things that maybe need to go wrong for it to get off the rails, as we saw, you know, last year or 2 years ago. But I just think there's some value there potentially in that. If you look at other ACC games outside of the Florida State game, there's not a single game with less than a 68% win expectancy. Coming off of an off week in week 9, Clemson welcomes Louisville. Then they have a road trip to Virginia Tech. Both of those 2 games projecting to be potentially some of the landmines, if you will, on that schedule outside of the game against Florida State.
Yeah, Clemson, when I said 5.5, it's minus 215 to the over. So really, they mean 6, you know, or even 6.25. Yeah, it's you would lean to the over then if the number is 5.5, I would imagine. But the truth is that the number, if you factor in the juice, is well higher than 5.5. You know, yeah, Klubnik, you know, he wasn't that impressive to me, but he does have a decent schedule, like you said. I think I only have him losing at Florida State and Georgia for sure. I think that at Virginia Tech and at Pittsburgh might be, you know, maybe a little bit tougher, but they have a pretty easy schedule if you look at the rest of them. You know, it's not like they're playing the top of the ACC. So no disagreement here with me. I do think that they should be able to get to 6 wins themselves. Let's move on to the next team. And this team is getting a lot of hype because we have a question here too from Dominic. He says, are you on the Miami Hurricanes hype train? There is a lot of people on that hype train. I'm not sure if I am. He said, personally, I can't trust the coach. Kelley, why don't you answer that?
So for Miami, and I know we're probably going to talk about them here soon. Like I said, from a talent standpoint, I am kind of on the hype train. I've got this team number 17. That's the highest power rated Miami has been in my model since 2016 when they finished the year number 13. If you look on the offensive side of the ball, I'm projecting number 21 right now. That would be, if they finish at number 21, that would be the best offense that Miami's had in the CFP era. The defense right now projecting number 36, which would be, you know, the best since the 2020 COVID year. They were really solid on the defensive side of the ball from 2016 to 2020, you know, top 30 team each of those years on defense. So number 36 this year on defense. You look at the schedule, it's among the easier in the Power Four, number 47 out of 68. There are 3 games on the schedule that my numbers make Miami a projected underdog. However, each of those games has at least a 41% win expectancy. Right off the bat in week 1 at Florida is 47%, and then back-to-back weeks, Miami's off in week 7. Week 8, they go to Louisville, 42% win expectancy. Week 9, they welcome Florida State, as I talked about earlier, 41% win expectancy. So there's only 3 games that you're projecting as an underdog, and in each of those games, you have at least a 41% win expectancy. Like, to me, there's a lot of upside there for Miami. Now, if they end up having some calls and plays like they did at the end of the Georgia Tech game last year, where you literally give away a game in which you had it won, like all you had to do was kneel and they failed to do so and they lost, I can't account for that. I don't know if that's going to happen. If it does, this season's going to get off the rails. But the upside is there for Miami. They're playing in the ACC, not the SEC. So I do think that Miami, just from a talent standpoint and a power rating projection, there's a path. And I think this is a team that certainly could find themselves in that discussion for an at-large spot late in the year, if not a spot in Charlotte.
Yeah. I mean, the talent that they brought in, I mean, more money, more problems, though, is kind of what I'm thinking. The old song from Puff Daddy. You know, the thing is about Miami is it takes a lot to gel. You know, the quarterback, Cam Ward, God, were we high on that dude after 5 weeks. And then all of a sudden, he loses five in a row. It's almost like he's the guy that you want to not believe in. And then all of a sudden, he shows up. And then once the pressure comes in and, like, they expect big things, you know, he could actually falter. I did like how he played Washington that final game in the Apple Cup. I thought that was the real performance that we should expect. And that's why, you know, there's so much hype on this team, but I think there's more pressure on Miami, especially that first week against Florida. Now, I do see some losses here in their regular season at Louisville. You know, that's tough. At Cal's tricky. Before at Louisville's tough. Florida State at home is the one that I don't have them favored in either. So they have their work cut out for them. Virginia Tech is supposed to be good. They do avoid NC State, but man, you know, Miami, like I said, all this money throwing it around. Imagine being in the locker room, Kelley, and, you know, this wide receiver that, you know, you never heard of the dude. He's making like $1 million and all these endorsements. And you're a pretty good linebacker, you know, and you weigh more than the guy. And you're looking at him. He's got his Porsche with him and stuff like that. I don't think that's good for locker rooms.
There's definitely a new dynamic now. And yeah, it is going to be interesting to see how that plays out when I'm getting this and he's getting that and he's not getting that. Like, yeah, it is going to be interesting. It's going to be a chemistry experiment. And I think it's going to be like that for a lot of teams almost every single year moving forward. You're not exactly going to know what you have and how they play together until it starts. This isn't the video game where you just collect as much talent as you can and roll it out and things work together perfectly. Like, that's not how real college football works in most cases. And so it will be interesting to see how well this Miami team and really a lot of teams can gel with how much turnover there is on the roster. And now we're seeing with a lot of coaching staffs too.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, I have Miami with 8 wins. So am I that far off the win total? The total? No, not really. I think that's kind of close to where they're at. So I think they're ranked probably properly, but I just can't trust them just yet. And I don't trust their coach, who can possibly drop a game to like a South Florida or something like that. You never know with this crystal ball. Next one I have is Louisville. And Louisville is also 5.5 conference wins. And what I wrote down, this team crushed it in the transfer portal, ranking number one on 3 net portal ratings. I don't know if you've seen on 3, but it's interesting how they netted out there rather than 247, where it's just all gross. Because you can see guys leaving, you can see guys coming back. I'm not a big Tyler Shook fan, though, man. You know, I didn't think he's that great of a replacement here. I do like Jeff Brohm. The problem with Louisville for me is the strength of schedule this year. What are your thoughts on Louisville?
I had Louisville projecting as the number 3 team in the ACC standings going into last year, and they made a run to the ACC championship game. I have Louisville projecting number 3 again this year. 5.6 is the average, but a 56% chance to win at least 6 games in conference play. Much like you, you know, there's a lot to be concerned about with this Louisville team, but there's also some things to like. I think the schedule difficulty that you talked about is going to be important. It's number 43 out of 68 in Power 4 overall. It's number 13 out of 17 in the ACC. So the schedule does set up nicely for the Cardinals yet again this year. Only 2 games on the schedule in which they're currently projecting as an underdog at Notre Dame in week 5. That's, of course, a non-conference game. And then week 10 at Clemson. That's going to be their toughest game of the year. They avoid Florida State. They avoid NC State. They get Miami at home, which I think is important here. So a lot of the contenders for the conference championship, Louisville either avoids or gets at home. So I think it's all kind of lining up for them again. I think they're going to be a little bit better than they were last year. The last 2 years, they finished number 22. I have them number 21 this year, so a slight improvement. The final game of the year at Kentucky is another game that you expect to be kind of a toss-up. But again, by then, they're going to know if they're in that ACC championship game or not. So I think Louisville's a team to watch out for this year in the ACC, not necessarily because they're the best power-rated team, but I think the schedule is really favorable for them for the second year in a row.
Yeah, without a doubt, the schedule is important. NC State's next at 5.5, and Grayson McCall comes in, you know, let's see if he can finish this out in his home state. He was a really highly touted quarterback at Coastal Carolina. What are your thoughts on NC State?
NC State, I've got 5.3 projected conference wins, 46% chance to reach six or more. It's been a theme here at the top of this conference. There's only two games that my numbers make the pack and underdog. Only one of them is in conference play. Week two at Tennessee is a neutral site, 30% win expectancy in that non-conference contest. And then week four, so right off the bat for ACC play at Clemson, it's a 26% chance for NC State. If NC State is 3-1, after four games, meaning they've split the Clemson-Tennessee, there is not another game the rest of the year in which my numbers currently make NC State an underdog. Now, the final game of the regular season at North Carolina is a 51% win expectancy. That's a toss-up. They could very easily be a slight underdog by the time that game rolls around. But if NC State is 3-1 or better after 4 weeks, I think this is a team that going into middle of November is certainly going to be squarely in the CFP conversation. Strictly because the number in the loss column is going to be so low, I think. It's the number 63 out of 68 most difficult schedule in all of Power 4, so it's a top 5 or 6 easiest schedule in Power 4, and it is the easiest ACC conference schedule by my numbers. Number 17 out of 17. They avoid Florida State. They avoid Miami. They avoid Louisville. They avoid SMU. They avoid Virginia Tech. NC State has a very manageable path, and this is a top 30 power rated team for me. I think NC State is a dark horse for the ACC title game because of this schedule.
And that's the thing. The schedule is fantastic. Obviously, we have to wait to see if, Florida State is that great, if Miami is that great, if somebody doesn't surprise us like a Cal or a Georgia Tech or a North Carolina, you know, and that's all about the fun of this. Cause you know, there's always going to be a team that we're like, wow, where'd they come from? You know, came from nowhere. And so right now we can only go by our numbers and what they show. And I do have NC State at 6.5 wins. You know, I mean, this is probably an overplay for me, you know, especially conference wins over 6.5 or over 5.5 conference wins makes a ton of sense from them. And that's what's fun about this because, you know, you can look at their win total. It's a lot higher than that. And then NC State's conference wins is a much more achievable one because, you know, during the conference, the Tennessee one, you know, you're not going to say that's going to be a win. That's a tough one out of conference. And so, you know, I'm not going to chalk that up as a win. But, you know, the total actually playing in the conference itself looks a lot more achievable. So, yeah, I'm gonna be playing that one. So that was just decided now. So good stuff. Let's move on to the next one. We have the Virginia Tech Hokies. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm pretty high on Virginia Tech themselves. This team returns a ton, as well as Kyren Drones, their quarterback. You know, they're fourth in returning production on Bill Connelly's ratings. They're 23rd in the net on three transfer portal ratings. They finished well last year, winning three out of their last four, and they were at a nice .9 net yards per play last year. They avoid Florida State, Louisville, NC State, and SMU. They do get Clemson at home, but they go to Miami. So I would call that a pretty fortunate schedule themselves. I think 9 wins is achievable from a total win standpoint. 12-1, I'm sorry, plus 1,200 to win the ACC is what I put a sprinkle on. I think Virginia Tech, if it's not NC State, can get to the ACC championship game.
Virginia Tech is interesting. I think this is going to be the best Hokie team we've seen if you remove the COVID year since maybe 2017. So I think they're certainly moving in the right direction. 2 years ago, this team was number 92 in my power ratings, number 118 on the offensive side of the ball. So it was a bad place in Blacksburg just a couple years ago. Certainly looking better now. And it's interesting for me with the projections for Virginia Tech this year because I'm projecting 5-3 in conference play as most likely. I'm projecting 8-4 overall as most likely. However, there's only two games in the entire schedule that right now Virginia Tech has less than a 50% win expectancy. Week 5 at Miami on a Friday night and week 11 at home against Clemson. Those are the only two games with less than a 50% win expectancy. This is the 65th most difficult schedule in Power 4 in the country. So that makes it what the fourth easiest schedule in all Power 4. It's among the top 5 or 6 easiest in ACC conference only play. So again, like I've said for a lot of these teams in the ACC at the top, you know, outside of Florida State and Clemson, who are the favorites, there's really like a second tier that's pretty full. And all of these teams can look at their schedule and say, man, if we can just get that game and that game and then take care of business in the games we're supposed to win. And those are big tasks, like asking for an upset, two upsets. Right. That's hard enough. And then to not be upset yourself, that's very, very difficult. So the way I'm explaining it probably makes it seem like, wow, everyone's just going to be winning a lot of games. Not everybody's going to win all these games, but one of these teams that we're talking about is going to be able to do just this, get their upset or two, and avoid stubbing their toe. And all of these teams have a chance to do that. Virginia Tech is in that boat as well. So, and I've got a 55% chance to win five or more conference games, only two games in which they're an underdog. But still, with that, I think 5-3 is probably the most likely record because, you know, they're probably going to stub their toe. You've also got, you know, multiple games, two, three games with less than a 65% win expectancy. So a lot of toss-up games in there too for Virginia Tech. But this is definitely a program that if you're buying stock, you want to buy it now because they're trending in the right direction, certainly.
All right. Trending in the right direction for sure, especially from last year. Let's move on. Do a little bit more rapid fire now that, you know, we still have a lot to cover. And North Carolina, 4.5 is their number. I just wrote Max Johnson transfers in with big shoes to fill after Drake May hits the NFL. Pretty good continuity, but, you know, those losses last year versus Virginia and Georgia Tech were kind of brutal. I could see 8 wins, but that might be the ceiling.
I've got 8-4 is the most likely, 52% chance to win 5 or more in conference play. So I would lean the over there. It's the second easiest schedule in ACC play and in the Power 4 as a whole.
All right, let's look at this wild card, baby, because SMU is so freaking interesting to me. I think it's the most interesting, like, transfer conference team coming in, well, at least to the ACC, but, like, even in college football, because SMU was really good last year. Lots of continuity on this ACC team now. Preston Stone's at the helm. This team has a relatively easy schedule, or they did last year anyway, but they lost their main games, their power games. They lost to Oklahoma, TCU, and Boston College in the bowl game. So it's kind of like, were they that good?
SMU, for me, was that good last year. I had them number 23 in the year-end power ratings. They're 27 coming into this year. But again, only two games in which they're projecting as an underdog. Back-to-back weeks, home against Florida State, on the road at Louisville. I've got a 43% chance to win at least 6 in ACC play. It's the third easiest ACC conference schedule and the third easiest Power 4 schedule overall. So if SMU is going to make some noise, it's going to be because of a combination of a top 30 team playing among the easiest Power 4 schedules in the entire country.
Yeah, I'm not seeing Clemson on there. I'm not seeing Virginia Tech on there.
And no, Miami either.
Or NC State.
Or North Carolina. So a lot of the contenders this team misses in conference play. You get Florida State at home. I mean, yeah, it's lining up nice for SMU, their first year in a power conference since the 90s.
That's just exactly what's making it super interesting here, too. So I'm going to be excited to watch them. Maybe place a few wagers on them this year. Syracuse, 3.5. Now you got Kyle McCord. You know, if there's a quarterback like Cade Klubnik, I kind of feel it's Kyle McCord. Of course, he got, you know, a little bit more dumped on from Ohio State and the fans. You know, he's heads out to Syracuse, and now you got Syracuse with a 3.5 conference win expectancy. I'm going to be honest with you, his numbers were good from an EPA standpoint last year, but just watching him, you know that when he got under pressure a little bit, he faltered a little bit. Fran Brown steps in as head coach. It's got me concerned with his lack of experience. I don't know. I'm not super high on Syracuse. What are your thoughts?
I think this team will go bowling. I've got a 78% chance to reach the 6-win mark. 7-5 is most likely. Only a 47% chance to reach 4 or more conference wins. So I would very, very slightly lean the under on the 3.5 there. Syracuse has the easiest schedule of any Power 4 team when you look at the totality of the 12-game slate. So the wins are there to be had on the schedule. However, from a power rating standpoint, this team, number 56, it's a big improvement from last year when they were number 75, but still not going to be good enough, I don't think, to be, you know, a serious contender in any sort of race.
Totally. They do have a very easy schedule. Oh, my God. It's so weird. It's like the bottom teams must have the hardest schedules in this. At the top seem to be pretty manageable. Let's move on to Pitt. Pitt's got a new OC. Cade Bell comes in and tries to talk Pat Narduzzi into scoring. you know, it's funny. It's going to be interesting in this one. I don't think – I'm not sure if Pat Narduzzi is going to let Cade cook, and you know how he is. It's just going to be more boring football. I know that Cade brought Western Carolina to like set 37.5 points per game last year, so that was cool.
Yeah, I mean, Pitt, I think they're going to be improved from a year ago. They really kind of fell off a cliff last year. They were number 34 in 2020, 13 in 2021, surprise run to the ACC championship game there. 2022, they're number 34. Last year, they're number 70. So things have really gotten off the rails there at Pitt. I'm projecting number 55 this year. 3-5, most likely conference record. You got a 56% chance to go bowling. So that's really what I think the aim should be for this Pitt team this year, is to make it to a bowl game and try to get things back on track, kind of the way they were in the early 2020s before last year.
Yeah, and 2.5 is their conference number. So we'll see if they can get back into the W section. Cal. Now, this team did great in the transfer portal, and I don't know. It's kind of weird to see that. Maybe, just maybe, it's Justin Wilcox's time to shine. Quarterback Fernando Mendoza's back. He got the team to a bowl game last year with a rough schedule. Now, they got a new OC in Mike Bloesch, and I don't know if he's going to keep the air raid from Jake Spavidal, but I think he is. The schedule looks easy. I think they should definitely get over 3.5 conference wins, because I took them over 5.5 total wins. I think Cal's such a wild card, and teams going out there might just not really take them seriously, and it's a good travel spot.
I like the over 5.5 overall wins. I've got a 66% chance to reach 6 and go bowling. The over 3.5 in the conference play, I've got 49% chance to reach 4 or more there. So a little bit closer on that one, but certainly the over on the overall season win total certainly would be in play by my numbers. I do think this team's going to be a little bit better than last year when they were number 54. I'm projecting number 47 this year. But again, I think bowling is really your goal here. And for Cal, it's really going to be just a season of attrition. With the amount of miles this team has to travel playing in the Atlantic Coast Conference, let's look at their road games. I mean, Cal goes to Auburn in Alabama. Cal goes to Florida State in Florida, at Pitt in Pennsylvania, at Wake Forest in North Carolina, and then at SMU down there in Texas. I mean, this team is going across the country to the Eastern time zone. Well, I guess Auburn's in Central, but going well across the country 4 times this year before a mid-country trip to SMU. It's just a lot of miles for this Cal team. I wonder what effect that will have on the players, on the coaching staff, just in general, to see how this team does this year. I think 6-6 should be the goal for this team.
Yeah, and I'm with you, because, and I took the 5-5 because I think Oregon State's going to easy win now that they're way down. They still get to play Oregon State. They get UC Davis and San Diego State at home, you know, for their non-con. If you look at conference, at Auburn is the other non-con, which is a little bit tougher, but I'm sorry, the actual conference, at Florida State, Miami, at Pittsburgh's going to be tricky. NC State's going to be tricky at home, and at Wake Forest. I see wins probably at Wake Forest, Syracuse, and Stanford at the end, but you better get those wins because the rest of them are tough. So I think that the over the 5.5 is better as well. But this is just such an interesting team here with Justin Wilcox. I've always been a Justin Wilcox fan since he was the defense coordinator at Wisconsin during the J.J. Watt, T.J. Watt days. So, I'll be keying in on this team. I think they go bowling, and I think you're right. It's a good goal to have to win 6-7 games and get into the bowling stage of things, because we still have bowls. Now, Wake Forest 2.5 is their conference wins. This was the worst Wake Forest offense that I remember watching in a long time, Kelly, from last year. Hank Bachmeyer transfers from Boise State, who's old enough to have kids in grade school. I'm not sure what they did in the transfer portal is even close enough, because they didn't do a lot. I see another poor year for Wake Forest.
Wake Forest offense last year was number 100 in my unit rankings. That's the worst they had been since 2016. You said 2.5 is the conference win total. I like the over there, actually, a 58% chance to reach at least 3 based on my numbers right now, but just a 45% chance to go bowling. So I do think that bowling, once again, is the goal for this team here if they can get there. If you look at the conference slate, so we have to get over 2.5. If we look at that, you're thinking Virginia, you know, in week 2, hopefully that's going to be one of those for you. You know, at Stanford, that is an ACC game now, which is crazy, but that's a 51% win expectancy. You probably need to get that one if you're going to go over the 2.5, and then closing the year against Duke at home, that could potentially be that third one. Maybe Cal on a Friday night, week 11, you're coming off an off week. Maybe that's a game that Wake Forest could get, but I got a 58% chance to win at least 3 in conference play for the Demon Deacons.
All right, cold wake on a Friday night. Let's see how they turn out, my friend. How about this? Virginia sitting here at 2.5. This team was frustrating to bettors. And the reason that was because they covered at 67%, but they sucked. They just covered all their spreads, man. It was just one of those teams that I thought wasn't good at all, but they just fought hard and kind of were in the games all the way to the end and just lost. What do you think about them with their great returning production?
Yeah, I've got Virginia certainly better than last year, but this team's been sub 80 in the power ratings each of the last 2 years. This year, they're number 74. I've got 4-8, maybe 5-7 is the most likely record here. 22% chance to go bowling. 2-3 conference wins is the most likely by my numbers. It's just, it's really hard to pinpoint these wins within conference play. I mean, you got to hope that Boston College at home, you're coming off an off week in week six here. You got to think that one is maybe one. But outside of that, my numbers right now don't make Virginia a favorite in any ACC contest. So it's just, where are you going to get these wins? Certainly you're capable of pulling an upset or two, but you're going to have to get Boston College at a minimum, I would think, to get that 22% chance to go bowling into play.
All right. That's going to be tough. Let's talk about another thing that's very tough. And that's Georgia Tech's schedule. Have at it. Have at it, Kelley.
I mean, this is not an ACC schedule. Like, that's the easiest way I can put it. They are the number 7 most difficult schedule in the country. They're by far the most difficult within the ACC. ACC-only games, they're number 1 as well. I mean, you play the number 12 most difficult collection of opposing FBS defenses in the country, the number 14 most difficult collection of opposing FBS offenses in the country. Georgia Tech's schedule looks like an SEC schedule. Like, that's the kind of the best compliment I can give them. And I'm not sure compliment's the right word, but because it's going to be difficult for them to win, but that's what it is. I've got 3 conference wins as the most likely record. 5-7 is your most likely overall, 28% chance to go bowling. You know, it starts with a neutral site game in Ireland against Florida State in week 0. Then you're going to have to rack up your wins. You got Georgia State next at Syracuse and VMI out of the FCS as your next 3 games before a road trip to Louisville, then finally an off week. So this team will have played 5 games through week 4 with the week 0 game, then an off week, then you get Duke at home. You've got to have some wins stacked by then. I mean, if Georgia Tech is worse than 4-2 at that point, I don't think there's any chance this team goes bowling, because the schedule the rest of the way, it's just too difficult. Like North Carolina on the road, Virginia Tech on the road, Georgia on the road, Notre Dame, Miami, NC State all come to Georgia Tech. It's just the schedule sticks out in the ACC because it's that difficult.
Like, exactly. 4 true home games. That's what I'm saying. It's like 4 or 5 because the Notre Dame one is in Atlanta and the Florida State one's at Ireland. So it's like, I see, I guess, Georgia State, VMI, Duke, Miami and NC State. So 5. Yeah, it's tough, man. Oh, God, that is just brutal for this team. I agree. What about a team that lost everybody like Duke when their win total's at 2.5 for conference wins?
Yeah, 2.5 for conference wins. I've got a 55% chance to go over there and get to at least 3. This team's going to take a big step back. I think that goes without saying. They were a top 30 team for me at the end of last year. Right now, they're hovering around number 60. The schedule starts out somewhat manageable. You know, in their first 4, 5, 6 games even, it's possible that Duke could be 6-0 through that. Then you have a really tough stretch in the middle there with Florida State, SMU, Miami, NC State. Probably going to be lucky to get 1 there before closing the season with a couple gettable games, but still going to be a projected underdog against Virginia Tech and on the road at Wake Forest. So this Duke team, I've got a 58% chance to go bowling, but we're going to know if this team's going bowling or not, I think, really by the first 4 or 5 weeks of the season with those games that they've really got to stack them early, kind of like we talked about with that other team before. So I think Duke is going to take a big step back. The schedule is not too difficult overall. It's among the 10 or 11 easiest in Power 4. But within conference play, it's up there, number 5 most difficult ACC slate.
Yeah, it is. Mike Elko being gone, their quarterback Riley Leonard going to Notre Dame. Manny Diaz is just – he's had a lot of failed stints, man. He was okay at Penn State as a DC, but – just maybe that's just because of talent. Malik Murphy, he didn't impress me at Texas. It's this team could flat out be the worst in the ACC, in my opinion. I'm not going to tell. I know you're bullish in some of these lower ones, but man, I'm expecting a lot of L's for Duke. Boston College speaking of pretty low, 2.5 is their number two. What do you have for Boston College?
Boston College had the easiest schedule in the country last year. This year, it's among the more difficult, at least with ACC ties. I've got them significantly improved, excuse me, from last year. They've really taken steps each of the last couple of years. They were number 100 2 years ago, 82 a year ago. I'm projecting number 62 this year. I've got 2 to 3 wins as most likely in conference play, 2.6 on average. And then anywhere from 4 to 6 wins overall, 5 and 7 certainly most likely, but a 38% chance to go bowling. There's a lot of games that are really kind of toss-ups. You know, win expectancy is between 30 and 70%. Very few that you're going to say Boston College is a decided favorite coming into this game. Duquesne out of the FCS ranks in week 2 and Western Kentucky in week 5, both at home. Outside of those games, Boston College is not going to be, at least right now, projecting as a significant favorite in any other game. So they're certainly going to have to win the close games and have a good record in one-score games for this team to go bowling, which I assign a 38% chance right now.
Yeah, and from a betting standpoint, these they're just a bunch of jokers to me. Losing to NIU and then you know, being Holy Cross by 3 points, and then they almost beat Florida State. It's like, come on, man. they were a very frustrating yin and yang team last year. Stanford finally 1.5 is their conference win total. I'm going to say that this team was trash last year, yet they somehow got a few interesting wins at Washington State, at Colorado. That was fun. Anytime someone beats Deion, it's pretty fun. It's going to be a really interesting year in Colorado. Returning production's high, but I don't think that's necessarily a good thing. They're returning a lot of guys that I don't like, but at the same time, I think I'd go over 1.5. 4 wins, I see them winning 4 games.
I agree with you on both those fronts. I've got 4-8 as the most likely overall record. I've got 2-6 as the most likely in conference play with a 64% chance to win at least 2 conference games. It is going to be a tough year for Stanford. An interesting thing about Stanford, I haven't taken this approach with many teams this year. Stanford plays the 5th easiest collection of opposing FBS special teams units. And we're really getting the weeds when we're talking special teams, I know, especially in the preseason. But the 5th easiest collection of opposing FBS special teams, and the special teams unit for Stanford in the CFP era has been a strength, and I'm projecting them to be in the 30s again this year. Could Stanford have a game or two where they make 1 or 2 big-time plays on special teams and really just change the game? Like, I think that right there could be the path for Stanford to winning a game that we don't expect right now. And it sounds weird, and it may not happen, but like it's lined up for Stanford more so than a lot of other teams where their strength, and it's a relative strength, on special teams, they don't face a lot of projecting strong special team units this year. All it takes is a play or two, and if they can get that, Stanford might win a game or two more than people are expecting this year. I've got 4-8 as the most likely, though, like I said.
Yep, 4-8. Yeah, it's over 3.5 for me. It's just almost a 4. Let's talk a little group of 5 while we have a few minutes left. American Athletic Conference, why don't you give me either an overrated or an underrated team from these conferences, if not both? We'll start with the AAC.
So with the AAC, and again, admittedly, Kiev, this is not my strong area to look at odds and assign all this, but I'm going to go with an underrated team here, maybe being UTSA. I see them right now with the 3rd shortest odds to win the conference championship. I actually have them as the very, very slight favorite in the American right now. So if you can get plus 500 on the team that I'm suggesting has maybe the best chance to do it, that to me right now is where I would go in the ACC with an underrated UTSA.
If you want to talk about UTSA being underrated, East Carolina is one of those teams that don't play them. But guess what? They also don't play Memphis and Tulane. So I'm looking at East Carolina here, over 6 wins. And I think I'm going to sprinkle a little bit on the AAC to win that at plus 1,600. Mike Houston has a decent defense, ranking 27th in scoring. The problem was the offense being completely putrid. But new offense coordinator John David Baker comes in from Ole Miss. And he tries to get one of these transfer guys going, either Jake Garcia or Caitlin Hauser. I'm not sure if that's been settled yet, but I'm semi-optimistic here. They get over 6 wins. 16-1 or 18-1 you can find to win the conference.
East Carolina has the easiest AAC conference slate of any team by my numbers. 7-5, the most likely record for me overall. But if you look at conference games in which they're a projected underdog, only 2 against UTSA, who we talked about, and then week 13, a slight underdog, 46% chance to win at North Texas. But again, if you've got a lot of implications on the line there for East Carolina late in the year, and maybe not North Texas, East Carolina may be a favorite in that game come kickoff.
Okay, so I misspoke. They avoid Memphis and Tulane. They get UTSA at home. That's it. Yep, that's what it is. They at least get UTSA at home. Okay, let's move on to Conference USA. So I got a shocking one for you, but let's see if we line up. Give me something in Conference USA.
I mean, I'm stretching here, Kim. Like, Liberty is the big betting favorite. I see they're -195 to win the conference. I've got them as by far being the best team in Conference USA. They're projecting with 6.8 regular season conference wins. That is more than a game. It's almost a game and a half more than the number two team there. If I had to go with maybe a slightly underrated team here, perhaps it's Jacksonville State. It's their first year of eligibility to compete in the Conference USA championship game, their first year to be eligible to compete in a bowl game, technically speaking, for at the FBS level. So if I go Jacksonville State, they have the third best odds to make it there, but I think they're the team that's most likely to match up against Liberty. So if they're able to get to that game, who knows? You know, they play on the road, though, at Liberty and at Western during the regular season. So don't feel great about this one, but Jacksonville State, my number two projected team, has the third best odds in Conference USA.
I've heard way too much about Liberty this year, man. Yeah, I know. I know. And they got money now and a great coach, blah, blah, blah. I'm going to go with UTEP here for a little bit. I think good things are happening in El Paso. You know, what's funny, Jake Brown comes in from Austin Peay. He won 9 games last year in the FCS. He brought a ton of his guys with him. I'm trying to remember who it was. I think it was Texas Tech who did kind of the same thing in a tougher division and made some serious noise over there like 2 years ago or so. Two solid quarterbacks in Cade McConnell, transfer Kyler Locklear. They're going to compete for the job. But I think they're going to be better than people think. I took them over their 4 wins. I think that I put a sprinkle at 60-1, and if they can just get to the championship game, then I can hedge out of that pretty simply. So I'm a little bit higher on UTEP than others.
UTEP for me, if I go to their page, yeah, I mean, they would be a long shot. There's not really any other way to say it. I've got them, you know, in terms of conference projections, 3-4 wins most likely. I've got a 23% chance to go bowling. So that would certainly be a team where if they pop off, I'd tip my cap to you because my model's not necessarily suggesting that UTEP has a lot in store this year.
All right, then remember that one, Kelley.
I'll
be expecting a tweet from you.
I'm ready to tip my cap.
That'll be exciting. Mac, we got Toledo. I'm taking Toledo under 8.5 wins in the Mac. Easy schedule, but Jason Candle's team lost almost everybody. I mean, Tucker Gleason, the quarterback, he was not good in the bowl game last year versus Wyoming. This is just a complete offensive and defensive line overhaul. They don't return anybody. There's a new running back. I took under 8.5 wins for Toledo.
I think Toledo under 8.5 is my model would support that, only a 46% chance to reach 9 or more. I was a little surprised to see Miami as the betting favorite to win the conference. I kind of thought it would be Toledo. My numbers do like Miami as well, but I thought I was out on a limb on that one. Clearly, I am not. I'll go with Ohio maybe as a team that's potentially under the radar a little bit. I've got Ohio projecting right now to be number 5 or 6 in the conference standing, or number 5 in the conference standings, but they've got like the 7th or 8th best odds to win the conference. So I think maybe there's a little bit of value there if you go down their schedule and look at who they're missing. You know, there's no divisions anymore in the MAC. The first year without divisions, they miss Bowling Green. They miss Western Michigan. They miss NIU. Those are some of those teams that are up there in the top 5 or 6 of the conference projected standings. Miami, you got to go on the road. Toledo, you're going on the road there. So it's not going to be easy, but I think Miami's a team that could surprise some people. They really don't face a lot of good offenses this year. The number 60 out of 66 most difficult collection of opposing FBS offenses in non-Power 4. And this defense in Athens should be a top 40 unit for me. So I think the defense is going to keep in a lot of games, and if they can surprise some people on offense and play a little bit better than my numbers are projecting, Ohio might be a team to keep an eye on.
All right, keep your eyes on Ohio this year. How about the Mountain West? Give me something out of the Mountain West that could be overrated or underrated. And if you want, I can go first.
I'd love for you to go first. Right, see what right, you got. Right.
I'm making you work here. Colorado State, baby. Colorado State over 6 wins. I think they get to a bowl, and if you get to a bowl, you're pushing at least. It's finally Jave Norvell's year, I said. You know, he fought hard last year against Colorado, and I feel like he's one of those coaches that these returning guys can kind of just latch onto for as a leader. He surprised me last year a little bit. Passing game should be good with Braden Fowler, Nicolosi returning as a starter. This team avoids Boise State, and they avoid UNLV. You know, I know they got Fresno, but Fresno now with Jeff Tedford, without their coach, could be a little bit more in disarray. So, yeah, man, I'm going to say Colorado State.
Colorado State, I got a 53% chance to go bowling, so I do think the numbers are slightly in the favor there. I think they're going to be improved this year overall and on the offensive side of the ball, so I don't hate that. I'll go Air Force, who I project to have the third highest conference win total, but it looks like they're, you know, plus 1,400, which is fourth on the board for winning the conference. Air Force has among the easiest schedules, or it is the easiest schedule in the Mountain West. They don't play Boise State. They don't play Utah State, who's another team that I expect to kind of be in that mix. UNLV they avoid as well. So Air Force is a team that I think, you know, if you look at their schedule, there's only a couple games at Wyoming in week 5, but Air Force is coming off of an off week there, and then Fresno State in week 11, but that game's at home. Those are the only two games that my numbers right now give Air Force less than a 50% chance to win in conference play. And again, both of those are 43 plus. So I think Air Force might find themselves in that Mountain West Conference Championship game. And if they do, anything can happen in that one game. So plus 1,400, which is the fourth shortest in the conference, is potentially intriguing.
Well, you must like Troy Calhoun then. This team doesn't return a lot of production. I think only two starters on offense. Now, there is some experience there. Don't get me wrong. It's an option type team that, you know, rotates guys in and out. So it's hard to really say all the time what a starter is. But that's one going out on the limb. I have Air Force is kind of in a rebuilding year. So we'll see. 14-1. You shouldn't be shocked, though, when it comes to Air Force. They're just one of those tough teams. I don't know. I don't know what the hell happened, though, after Colorado State last year, man. You lose to a bad Army team, but you lose at Hawaii. UNLV is understandable now, and at Boise State's understandable, but then they finally go to the bowl, and everyone's down on them, and they smoke James Madison by 10 points. They were just so weird at the end of the year.
They were weird, and it's just those service academy teams are just hard to pinpoint time to time. I agree with you on offense. They're projected to take a big step back if they can, you know, they have a lot of experience, not necessarily from the starting standpoint, and they do have that interesting offensive scheme. So we'll see. I don't know. I'm guessing over here, Kiev, with this kind of betting stuff here.
Of course you are, but that's the fun of it, my man. Educated guesses is what we call it, and I've got a really poor educated guess for the next one for you in the Sun Belt, and I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to bet on a coach that I've been fading the last 10 years. And I'm not excited about this bet because I should be slapping myself afterwards, but I think Arkansas State goes over 5.5, and I think Arkansas State, it could be a long shot to win the Sun Belt at 16-1. And this is Butch freaking Jones, and Butch Jones at Tennessee was absolutely terrible. I almost think that maybe he just kind of figured out how to coach a little bit. And quarterback Jalen Raynor was really good last year. Did you see how they scored 77 against Texas State last year? That was fun. Let's just get the over ourselves, guys. The Red Wolves returned 9 offensive starters out of 11. That's interesting. Now, it's just the defense that can't be trusted, I guess. But they did get some transfers in. Maybe they can win this thing in a year that they avoid James Madison and App State. They avoid those teams. And Troy and South Alabama are in massive rebuild. It's more about that for me that kind of takes the long shot, being that Troy and South Alabama are in rebuild and App State and James Madison are not in their schedule. So I have a very hedgeable situation if they make it.
61% chance to reach 6 wins and go bowling for Arkansas State. So I would be with you on that one. Certainly think they're going to be improved, especially on the offensive side of the ball. For me here, I'll go with probably an unpopular pick, but I'm going to go with James Madison. And I know what they lost, coaching staff, players, all of this. This has been a really good team each of the last 2 years. I actually think they're going to be worse than they've been either of their previous 2 years at the FBS level. This is the only conference, though, that still has divisions. I still have James Madison as the favorite in the East Division, and they have the fourth best odds to win the conference championship. So my division favorite has the fourth best odds to win the conference. I think I'm going to go with James Madison here. If you look at the schedule, it's the easiest in the East Division. They play the easiest collection of opposing FBS defenses, and there is only one game within conference play that my numbers right now make James Madison a projected underdog. That is Week 13 at App State, who is the conference betting favorite right now, it looks like, online. So that's a huge game. It is on the road. I know that. But if James Madison is able to go 7-1 in conference play, I think they might have a chance to make it to that Sun Belt Championship game. And once they're there, it's the best record in conference that hosts. That very well could be James Madison, because I think that West Division might beat itself up a little bit in conference play. And that winner might have, you know, potentially two, could even have three losses. So certainly you wouldn't think they'd be hosting at that point. So I think James Madison at plus 800 maybe has a little bit of value to win the Sun Belt. I think people are fading them a little bit too much given everything that they lost. Understandable to a degree, but I think it's gone a little too far.
Man, when the Sun Belt finds an FCS school to come in, they seriously tend to take over, because App State, I remember when it happened with App State, mm-hmm. and then now you had James Madison that just completely took over. It's like these FCS teams are bringing in are better than the rest of the conference in many cases. So it blows my mind. But they are a football school, and it's one of those situations, though, maybe even though they lost everybody, it's one of those that they can just rebuild really quickly going against this type of competition. But I'm cool with it, man, because Arkansas State, not in the App State. Coastal Carolina, James Madison, Georgia Southern side of things. And I think that's going to give me an opening for my little hedge bet coming into this. And this is the only conference with divisions left. Everybody mm-hmm. else got rid of divisions, which is very nice for some teams and worse for others. But, man, we went, like I said, an hour and 15 minutes. Great stuff, Kelley. Love talking to you, man. You're so knowledgeable, and I can't wait to follow you this whole year on Twitter and check out your ratings every single week. Where could our listeners and viewers find your great information?
Well, Kiev, thanks for having me. As always, I really appreciate it. Have a great time. And you challenged me to stay under an hour. I clearly fell short of that challenge, so my apologies. But you guys can find me on X at KFord Ratings, on the website, kfordratings.com. Again, just love talking college football. So, Kiev, this was a blast. And thanks again, man. I really appreciate it.
All right. Make sure you guys check out Kelley Ford Ratings at kfordratings.com. All right. To recap, I'm adding to what we've already released on other shows, the over. Conference wins for NC State, 5.5. I really like that one. And Arkansas State, we're also going over 5.5 wins if you haven't gotten that one before, both 4-1 stars. My friends, thank you so much for listening to this episode of the Odds Breakers. If you are interested in capping at the Odds Breakers, feel free to contact us at info@theoddsbreakers.com or on our Twitter at the Odds Breakers. Have a great weekend. Enjoy all the games and go get some winners.